First time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
I actually called a few minutes ago. I apologize about that mishap right there. What I had to say before...
No. The reason that I didn't allow you on the air is because you used language that was inappropriate
that.
On the air. One more chance. You do it again, you're out of here forever. Eternity. All right?
Ain't going to happen again. What
All
happened
right.
was the phone had rang at 4 in the morning, rang one time, and I believe the ghost... Have you ever heard of ghosts haunting people in their dreams?
Well, I don't know. What's the deal with it ringing one time? So
it rang one time, and through the speakerphone thing, there was a really weird voice, and I couldn't make out exactly what it was saying, but it sounded almost like, go to sleep.
Well, I get those all the time, though. Usually,
At first I thought it was my friend messing around.
Well, usually it's somebody trying to sell me something. I mean, how do you know?
At four in the morning?
Oh, they'll call.
Four in the morning. And not only that, we checked the caller ID. It happened three times that night, right after where my friend had gotten up, walked out in the other room. He thought I was messing around. I'm like, no. And I thought he was messing around. No. The phone wasn't in their room. The phone wasn't nowhere. In the morning, the phone ended up being found in the bathroom. So that's weird right there. We checked the caller ID. There was no recollection of a call coming in at that point in time in the morning or anything. And it happened three times, a very weird voice. I guess like also the my friend's girlfriend that lives here said the ghost is like she's seen it before. A hag? Old lady?
Did you say a hag?
A hag. That's what she described it as to me, and it almost sounded like, go to sleep.
Go to sleep. Well, then, that's what you should have done. Headed for the sack. Wild card line, you're on the air. Hello.
Me?
You.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
hi.
My name's Tim. I'm calling from Oklahoma, but I'm listening to a station out of San Antonio.
All right, Tim. Welcome to the program.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, this story begins in a hospital, actually, before the ghost, if you can call it that, came about. But my dad died about 15 years ago, and the night before he died, some people told me to tell him that they had been to the hospital but hadn't been in to see him because they felt like they needed to just keep it together and be support for the family and stuff.
Sure.
And the next morning, he died. And immediately after that, just right at the same time, a clock stopped in their house and would not start back up again. A couple of months later, I was on a train from St. Louis to Minneapolis, which was several hundred miles away from where my dad died.
Right.
And when my dad had been in the hospital, he was in a coma for about a week. I kept meeting people that he worked with who were coming by the hospital, and they kept telling me, your dad is really proud of you. He talks about you all the time. And that phrase, your dad is really proud of you, is important. Because several months later, when I'm on this train, I went to the car behind the one we were riding in, which they had cleared out the car because they were going to drop it off overnight. But I had to go back there to use the bathroom because the bathroom in our car didn't work. There was one man back there.
Right.
And a very old black man with white hair. And as I passed him, we made eye contact, and he said, I talked to your father the other day. He's really proud of you.
Just out of the blue, he said that.
Just out of the blue. Yeah. And so, this was in the middle of the night. I was about half asleep, so I didn't really think a whole lot about it. And as I got back to the car, I told the steward in the car I was riding in about it. Said, there's an elderly gentleman back there who seems a bit confused. Can you go back and check on him? And so the
less
steward
than,
goes
we've
back.
Got less than a minute here.
Okay. The steward goes back there and comes back up a couple minutes later by himself, just looking at me like, what are you talking about?
There was nobody. there.
Nobody. So I think I got a message from beyond.
It sounds very much like you did.
Yeah.
All right, sir. I appreciate your call.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. You're listening to Ghost AM. We invite your ghost stories. If you had something really scary happen to you, then we've got the phone lines. Let's you and I rock. This is Ghost to Ghost AM.
This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
It's Ghost to Ghost all night long tonight. Good evening, everybody. If you've got a really good story, we've got the telephones. Even though we appear to have a slight malfunction in the long-distance lines right now, we'll work with it, and we'll keep taking your story. So lay heavily into the first-time caller line, the wild card line, and you'll do just fine for a little while here. But they are having a typical Halloween kind of problem on long-distance lines. That's just the way it goes. Expect these kinds of troubles on nights like this. Top of the evening to you all as we continue with Ghost to Ghost. We'll see how we do here with regard to whether we go 5 hours or not. I'm not sure about these telephones, but we'll make a good Halloween try. First-time caller line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hey, is this me?
Yeah, well, only you know that for certain, but it sounds like you. Sounds just like you, actually.
Well, I've been listening for a long time. I want to thank you and George for getting me through the night. I drive a truck. I'm sitting on the side of the road just outside Gallup, New Mexico. My name's Meade.
Well, all right. Welcome to the program, and you're very welcome. Happy to keep you awake. Awake is our job.
Yeah, I'll do a good job sometimes.
So, what's up?
Okay, real quick. About 1993, my grandfather had emphysema, and he was sick for a long time, and I was praying, you know, that he wouldn't pass and this, that, and everything. Well, he did, and I got real angry and, you know, had a fit there where I was cursing God and this, that, and the other thing. And during that time, my mother was just distraught. I mean, it almost destroyed her. And every time I seen her, she's upset. And then I seen her, you know, at one time, and she's fine. She's happy, back to herself again. I'm like, what's wrong with you? And she said that she was sleeping in the house where they lived in Tennessee, and it was still dark outside, and she woke up with a light, and my grandfather was standing there, and he told her, you know, Kay, you grieve so long, you know, stop it. I'm in a glorious, glorious place. I wouldn't leave, you know, if I could.
Yes.
And that, you know, that calms her down. Well, that made me mad for two reasons. One, I didn't believe it. And the other one was that, you know, why didn't he come see me? I'm just as messed up as she was. And then I got thinking about it, and I was joking with people, well, the reason he wouldn't is because I'm famous with my friends for being spooky. You can open a door. They got hobbies of scaring me. And so I'd probably just leave him whatever room he was in and be gone.
You're sounding a little spooky now. Your cell phone's breaking up, so.
Okay. Anyway, I was sleeping, and I dreamed about him. And for the time he was, for like 2 years, my grandmother had paid to have a lake dug on their farm. And she had sunk all this money into digging Blumen Lake, and it would never hold water. And so when I dreamed about him, give you the short version, we went to the lake, and it was full of water. And the following day, I went to my grandmother's house because it freaked me out. And sure enough, the doggone thing, and it hadn't rained, Art, in like 6 months. And the thing was just full of water. And, I mean, it cured me.
It changes the way you believe things and what you believe, doesn't it?
Well, I mean, it's just inexplicable. I mean, there was no rain, and, you know, for 2 years it would rain. And
I'm with you. It's quite clear. It was another message. Well, I don't know if that's enough. I too had a message, and I think that was a message from my father. But, you know, I'm the kind of person who just requires this incredible, unobtainable, ironclad proof, and I haven't had it yet. But that's why I listen to these stories with intrigue, because there are so many of them. It's so common. There's got to be something to it, don't you think? Wildcard line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, Art.
Hello.
Hi, this is Joan in Alexandria, Virginia.
Hey, Joan.
and I'm listening on, I don't know what it's called anymore, but it's 570 AM
in Virginia somewhere.
Okay. Well, it actually comes out of Bethesda, Maryland, which is on the north end of Washington, D.C., and I'm on the south end.
Gotcha. Okay.
Okay. I'm calling to tell you about a friend's house in North Carolina was built about 15 years ago, right out on the Outer Banks, one dune away from the ocean.
Yeah, Hurricaneville.
Yes. And we've known these people for a long time. They have a very large, multi-generational family, and they're always inviting other people to come and stay there. And so we went down one time to visit, and she said, "Now I want to warn you before you come that we do have a ghost, or multiple ghosts."
Oh.
And I said, "Oh, great. I just thought that was super. I have my chance." And she told us that there was a woman who walks through one certain bedroom who wears a dark, long, body-fitting dark vest with many buttons down the front, and she has a white blouse underneath it with long, loose sleeves. And that one time she walked in the room and somebody had put a crib with a baby there, and she walked right through the crib and the baby, and the mother was just horrified, took the child and went to a motel for the night, never stayed in the house again.
A normal reaction, I think.
The night we were there, my friend's giant 6'4" brother had slept out on the porch because the house was really crowded. And he came running in the middle of the night, terrified, because of all the boot stamping out on the porch. There were all these loud footprints. So the other aspect of this was that in the wintertime, when neither she nor her family members are there, there is one permanent family just on the other side of some bushes, you know, two houses, the length of a normal two house away. So it's maybe 100 feet away.
Right.
And they complained to her one time because of all the party noise all winter. And yet they didn't know who was staying there, so they were concerned that someone was breaking into the house because there were lights all night, and their lights would move from one room to another as though people were not using the electricity, which was turned off for the winter, so they were using candles or oil lights or something. And that there was all this raucous partying going on all the time. So finally my friend contacted not an exorcist, but a psychic who lived down in the Outer Banks in North Carolina. And over the years, she got to know the locals, and she had heard about this woman, contacted her, and she came to visit the house and said that there was a shipwreck on that particular site. And that they, when they constructed the house, it had dug into it. And the ghosts were all disturbed, but they figured, well, if you put a house here, we'll just live in it. But that they were actually shipwreck victims. So the exorcist or the psychic, I don't know whether she did magic, you know, I don't know what sort of thing she did, but she asked them to leave, that it was alarming renters, and the family didn't mind, and they accepted it, but would they please leave?
Did it work?
Yes.
They left.
Uh-huh. So, and the neighbors said they now see lights in the wintertime, the dead of winter, when there's no one else around, you know, for miles, because this is just this narrow.
So you mean they still occupy it when nobody's there?
But not their house.